Thanks, Trish, for the nice introduction. I'm Jack Rojahn from the University of Canberra and eco-DNA group. And today I'm going to be talking about improving eDNA detection frameworks for an invasive pest species, which is the red-eared slider turtle. Before I begin, I just wanted to just give a really quick snapshot into my PhD overall. Obviously, it's eDNA-based, but I sort of have tied that into an urban ecosystems theme as well. So looking to monitor urban biodiversity using eDNA. And I think a lot of the themes that have come out of the conference so far about talking about real-time detection and real-time methods are useful to something like urban biodiversity, because a lot of the byproducts that come from these tools can be applied by people such as citizen scientists and people who already sort of are using other data sets anyway. So I think it's a real utility to use eDNA in an ecosystem such as urban environments. Here you can see me being a goofball on a green roof. And in the top left, also using a rapid extraction method to monitor, look for a red-eared slider DNA. So my target species for this research was to use eDNA to monitor red-eared slider. And as Oliver just pointed out fantastically, it's an extremely invasive species, but completely legal in America. It's really tolerant of urban ponds and water bodies, which makes it quite appropriate to monitor here in Australia, particularly places like Sydney. And because it's so prevalent in the pet trade, it makes eradication really difficult. And so we do have quite an active management strategy here in Australia, looking to contain and monitor these red-eared sliders. And eDNA has been pitched as being appropriate to monitor a lot of species across a lot of taxa. And reptiles are actually proving to be a little more challenging, but nevertheless, it's important that we still try and investigate how we could go about developing a framework to monitor these guys. So when I talk about eDNA, I'm really just talking about DNA that exists in the environment and is shed by organisms. And it follows a workflow like the one described here, where we have a collection phase, whether it's water or air or soil. We capture that DNA onto, say, a filter paper or another method. We extract it, and then we use PCR to amplify that DNA. Now, recently, like many other fields of research, eDNA is kind of going through a growth phase where we're looking to both to basically reduce time that a workflow takes. And one way we could do that is by simply cutting out stages in the workflow. And at the same time, we could also make it just compact everything into a shorter time frame. So, for example, Biomeme offers products that you can do real-time PCR in the field. And Nanopore is another great example of basically we can sequence something in a field in a really rapid time. And obviously the implications for this are really, really important because decisions can be made sooner. And then therefore something like managing invasive species could, you know, significantly reduce the impact or improve monitoring of those incursions from the get-go. So really important that we continue to investigate how appropriate these methods are. But at the same time, these methods really need to be appropriate in terms of the whole framework. So here's me sampling with eDNA, and it needs to be relevant to the management of turtles. So we have Nathan here in New South Wales, who's doing some red-eared slider research, and Stacey in Queensland. But it's also really dependent on the shedding physiology of the target species. In this case, it's the red-eared slider. We know that eDNA is really appropriate for monitoring fish and amphibians. But today has been a bit of a challenge with trying to monitor reptiles. And I wanted to really highlight that because it's important that we sort of talk about when eDNA is appropriate and how to use it and when maybe it's not so appropriate. So what I really wanted to do for this was basically compare monitoring of red-eared slider DNA using our portable methods. So something like our Biomeme DNA extraction protocol, which takes about 5 minutes. And our qPCR machine here, which you can run with your phone, versus our sort of tried and tested extraction kits, which we use in our specialized sort of labs and other sort of utility methods as well. And I basically just straight out of the gate conducted a control tank experiment where I had two turtles sitting in a tank and then took samples over time to see if I could just flesh out at least where we're at in terms of eDNA extraction to see how appropriate that would be at the site level. And it's really important that we do this because sensitivity, we know that eDNA, one of the great things about it is that it's extremely sensitive. But if we're losing that sensitivity in trading off for something like time, that needs to be explicitly kind of stated. So I run my extraction treatments over 7 days. So I have 7 days of sampling here, and I divided them into three extraction treatments. So my occasion kit here, a Biomean kit with a little filter paper, and then just the stock standard Biomean protocol. And I'm using CT value here as a proxy for DNA concentration in the sample. So a lower CT value would indicate that we have a really high DNA concentration. And as we go up in CT value, we're losing that DNA concentration in the sample. And also what's really important to know about this is that, for example, here, our Keijin kit had a CT value of about 27, but as opposed to the Biomean kit, which had a CT of about 37, that's about a 1,000-fold difference in DNA concentration to start with. So right out of the gate, even just using a simple extraction method, you can see that concentration-wise, this is kind of going to cost us a lot in sensitivity. Now, that's really important to know when we take it to the site level, because it would be great to say, hey, everyone, take a DNA sample for us, extract it, send it into the lab. But there still needs to be a bit of time, I think, before you can begin to implement something like this for Reddit sliders. I'm not saying there's not room for that in other applications. Another interesting point here is that, for example, even though I had turtles here for 4 hours, here my Biomean extraction protocol wasn't able to recover DNA, which is a bit of an issue. And it also leads on to other things like, could we say how many turtles are here? That would be, again, really challenging using a simple extraction protocol. Yep, that's great, but at the same time, kind of not being able to tell us too much information. So from there, with this information, I went out to my field sites, and this is kind of a typical field site in Sydney. It's an urban kind of pond dam. You can see a slider hanging out here. Took my eDNA sampler out with me, and I went and sampled across 8 or so sites, and I repeated sampling as well. And these sites were chosen because they sort of had low occupancy of turtles, and also they were being utilized by DPI for their trapping and management of turtles. And I ran my data and I got big sad face, and that was kind of disheartening, but at the same time I was like, that's really interesting, this works really well for other species, and what's kind of going on here. So coming back again to the physiology and shedding rates, we can see something like a turtle and a fish have a very different way of shedding DNA into the environment. And that's really important to consider when we're kind of implementing these sampling strategies. For one, this turtle's hanging out of the water. It also has scutes and stuff that may not be shedding so much. And on top of that, it has really interesting life stages. So for example, it goes into brumation for part of the year, and it's really dependent on its metabolism to shed DNA and grow. And ultimately that could make it really tricky to detect using something like eDNA, as opposed to this fish, which you could imagine maybe at a site is kind of just moving around a lot more. It's knocking about dispersing DNA much more evenly. So combined with those two things, we can kind of see that there is going to be a little bit of a challenge here to implement eDNA for Reddit slider research. And this is sort of highlighted again with in literature, there is a bit of a rate of false negatives, so that we know the turtle's there, but we're not getting any detection. Just to illustrate this point a bit further, I was able to come across a site in Sydney, which was essentially a pit. In other words, it sort of had some vegetation and it's about 4 by 6 meters. What was really interesting was that they housed turtles here that were being trapped out by DPI, and they decided to put these turtles into like a little pocket of this little pit. So it was about 9 turtles in there. And I thought that was a really interesting way to kind of articulate maybe what's going on with sort of our eDNA sampling strategies here. So for example, we would expect that maybe eDNA might disperse over time, or at a large scale site, what would happen if we knew that density was really low? And so what I did was I just took took samples from 6 points around this pond on 2 occasions. And I basically wanted to know, were my CT values, again, so my starting DNA concentration in the sample, going to be different even in this small area? And basically what I found was that my samples that I took right next to the turtles, as you'd expect, had really high quantities of DNA, so 28 and 26 on both occasions. But even in such a small radius from here to, say, sample 6, you can see that that's ballooned out to 32, nearly 33, which is at least a 10-fold difference in DNA concentration over a really small space of area. And I found that really interesting, because densities of turtles, Reddit sliders, particularly in a place like Sydney, may not be this high. Also, if you're thinking about sites such as like Centennial Parklands, which is massive, you're going to run into some issues to really be able to figure out what is going on here. And then finally, we took the totals out and I took a sample 1 week after they were removed. And you can see the DNA concentration kind of homogenizes and is gradually kind of decaying out as well. So that's also another interesting little thing. So bearing this in mind, it kind of was like, okay, that's really interesting again. Using a graph from Ferlin, one of my supervisors, she had a study site in Tasmania looking at carp density. And basically she modeled out how confident you could be to detect carp depending on the amount of fish and how many samples you would need. As we can see here, as the number of fish in this case reduces, it goes up to 1,000 samples, which is ultimately not that effective. And so from my perspective, it really got me thinking about how can we best use our resources here, whether it's eDNA or whether it's for something else. And also from an eDNA perspective, are eDNA methods actually appropriate for something like reptiles when we know that for fish they can work quite well, but we're having some challenges with reptiles and specifically turtles. And so some considerations from this would obviously be, you know, how could we compare this with conventional monitoring, understanding the density and scale we're working with, and again, the available resources. And so I was thinking like, well, how could I kind of improve that detection probability? And what we came up with was to use swab sampling. So in Queensland, I was lucky enough to work with Malcolm up in Queensland, and I asked him just to send me some swabs from pontoons they'd set up there. And as you can see here, we've got some redded sliders hanging on a pontoon, and I asked him to swab them for me. He sent them down and I ran them and I got some really good detection. And I found that really interesting because, first of all, we'd kind of gone for this approach where it was kind of, you know, stabbing in the dark about where these turtles might be. And then we figured out, well, maybe if we kind of targeted a bit more, that might be a bit more appropriate for actually getting some detection out of it. And it seems to be that's the case so far. So out of these swabs, everything's been really interesting. I got this really interesting detection at another site here, which I was told didn't have turtles. But what's kind of interesting is that that's actually looking at the sites themselves. Potentially that could be a turtle that's kind of wandering between the two sites as well. So going forward, I've asked both DPI and Queensland's DAF to collect some more swabs for me to see how much this could be useful, I guess, to sort of improve our detection probabilities of turtles, redded sliders in this case. And again, the other interesting thing about this is that traditionally eDNA water sampling can be a bit of a hassle, whether it's, storing water samples or filtration, whereas something like a swab is really easy to use. It can be sent, you know, from the air straight to me. And so I think, again, considering that, we can kind of say a lot about the resources that we have at our disposal and how best to use them. Thanks, mate. Just some concluding remarks here before I finish up. I think it's really important that we continue to, it's obviously really important to be able to detect invasive species in an accurate and quick manner. It obviously has a big implication for management of them. But at the same time, we still need to consider where we're at in terms of our methods and our strategies and identifying the trade-offs here. So it might be perfectly reasonable to use real-time, you know, eDNA extraction methods for some application, but it's important that we specify sort of the downside of it. And often that would be in the case of something like sensitivity. And as we know, as I've just kind of shown, that we can see with turtles that we have a bit of an issue with their sensitivity anyway, because they're not shedding so evenly. So identifying that, I think, is really important. I'm not saying that's not important to continue working on our real-time and portability. And again, there's some really good applications for that. And then again, thinking about it as a whole too, so eDNA is obviously a fantastic field and we have lots of cool ways that we can use it, but perhaps in the case of these turtles, it's not the most appropriate way, or something like the swab testing could really improve that detection probability. But again, overall, it really depends on having those multiple tools in the toolkit, I think, and I think it's really important that we sort of consider all of that when we're implementing our management strategies. So that's it. I'd just like to acknowledge my supervisors, Professor Diane Gleason, Dr. Elise Ferlin, and Dr. Alejandro Trillo Gonzalez. Also, a big shout out to Malcolm Kennedy and Nathan Cutter for working with me so far on the redded slider research, and KISS, specifically Tony Buckmaster, and also my fellow students. And thank you all for listening.
Thank you very much, Jack, for a great talk. I've got a quick question. Did you change the temperature, or did you see whether there might be a difference in shedding with feeding or with urination, which might be higher if they're more active during hot temperature?
That's a really good question. part of my research will investigate their shedding rates, and it's important that we do that across taxa. So far, I've got that lined up to do, as in, you know, you're right, in terms of temperature, feeding behavior, and there are some cool stuff I can do with that. So at my disposal at the moment, I have 6 redhead sliders that I have a license for. And so I will run some of those shedding studies out, and that will no doubt influence detection rates. Yep.
Excellent. There's a few questions online for you. There's one asking you, do you think you could use the same kind of methods to identify presence of secretive species such as quolls at low density?
Yeah, I think that's perfectly viable. Swab testing is interesting. It's kind of swab testing, I think, is an interesting way to get around some of the challenges we have with something like eDNA, more water sampling or soil sampling. But it's really dependent. I think there needs to be a lot of communication about how we tailor this to certain taxa or certain groups. So, for example, fish are really well represented in eDNA research, but there's less done on, say, terrestrial species. Some interesting research out there on eDNA, for example, Elise again has a really great study about sampling from waterholes and all the terrestrial biodiversity you can pick up from something like a waterhole. I think it's viable for sure. Yep.